It's now time for our main event with your host, Chris Tetrault Blaine. Welcome to Once Upon a Turnbuckle.
Hi, everyone, and thank you once again for joining us here on Once Upon a Turnbuckle. What is actually quite a milestone episode. It is actually our 50th episode from start to finish. So for this, I'm really, really pleased to bring back one of my favourite guests that I've spoken to previously on the show. Spoke to him last year. The one and only Tom Fleming. Welcome back to Once Upon a Turnbuckle, sir.
Thanks so much. And yeah, good to be back, man. You know, been doing the whole WWE revival for a while now. So yeah, you were one of the first podcasts that I did an interview with when it all started coming back around.
It was very, very cool. It was brilliant for me. Anyone who hasn't seen the episode, firstly, I will say, once you've seen this one, go back and watch it. We'll probably bring up some of the stuff we spoke about, but we won't cover old ground too much. But you know, the work that you did back then for WWF, it's like still ingrained in me. It was like part of my childhood, you know, some of the imagery and the you know, the looks and everything that you created. And one of the reasons why I wanted to bring you back on, not only because I had so much fun talking to you, you've got some more stuff on the go, very exciting in the wrestling realm as well as everything else that you're doing. We'll touch on that and we'll bring people up to speed on that. So so it's been about a year. I think last time we spoke, you were just preparing to, it was the new artwork with Brian Clark, Adam Bomb, that you were getting ready to release, I believe, or had just released.
Yep.
That was quite cool. That was cool. Have you got any more kind of things lined up with him that you know of, or anyone else like in that realm?
No, actually, I've been so busy between the stuff that I'm doing for Marvel Comics and then this big project that I just finished up. I've been so busy and stuff, but I'm in regular touch with Brian, and you know, we talk about doing a show together, and and we'll see, you know, when the stars align and stuff, and we'll make that happen.
It's very cool watching, you know, the him come back, because he's been away from the spotlight for so long until sort of last year, and then he's kind of literally, pardon the pun, exploded back on the scene, and it's fantastic some of the stuff that he's got.
And you know, it's really cool he has such great characters that they're very marketable. He's working really hard on you know, all the projects that he's involved with new action figures and all the merchandise and stuff. And it just totally relates to the whole comic book thing. And just really, you know, he just has really fun, cool characters. Yeah. And it's really nice to see one of the guys from back in the day make it out healthy and, you know, and well.
Yeah, yeah. And actually, you know, touching on one of the things I was going to bring up, actually, because one of the guys we did speak about, one of the bits of work that you did for the WWF that we know you best for, and that I think we did talk at length about last time, was Razor Ramon, Scott Hall. Sadly, obviously, you know, a couple of months ago, I believe, we sadly lost him. You shared a particular memory of working with him when you were designing his look on the last episode. You got anything that springs to mind that you've kind of been reflecting on recently because of that?
When I got the news, it was actually kind of a weird thing. I got the news, like, you know, I believe on like Facebook or something, you know, like I didn't even get it directly from anybody and stuff. And yeah, that was a real bummer, you know, because it would have been nice. It would have been nice to see Scott again. And, you know, all these years have passed and stuff, and I never had the opportunity where he was at like a show that I was at or anything like that, where, you know, some of the other guys I was fortunate to see and talk to, Animal from, the Legion of Doom. And he actually was really glad. He signed one of the posts. That was my first job I ever did for the WWF. And he signed, he was like, oh man, he goes, you know, this is one of the best selling posters. I haven't seen this in, you know, decades. And we were actually able to kind of, you know, chit chat and talk for a little bit about the old days and stuff. And I didn't get to do that with Scott, but you know, I got a lot of messages with people, you know, hearing about and knowing now that I was behind the design of the costume and things like that. So, you know, it's just, you know, it is what it is.
It's one of those, it came out of left field, you know, one minute we knew he had health problems here and there, but nowhere, you know, literally within a few days.
And yeah.
I think that's what makes it worse, isn't it?
And it makes it tougher knowing that it was kind of like a freak thing. Like it wasn't even like his health decline. It was like, you know, he was on the operating table or something, you know, so it was an unforeseen, nobody really, I guess, could prepare for it as far as family and things like that. So it was just terrible news. And the wrestling world lost a legend.
They did. Yeah. Say what you will. I think you helped sculpt, let's be honest, you know, yes, he had a name for himself in WCW, but it wasn't until the iconic Razor Ramon era, which you obviously had a hand in, cementing in us all. It was, you got to take, a great deal of pride in that, knowing that, I would imagine.
Yeah, that was very proud of that. Yeah. Definitely one of the biggest that I was involved with. So, yeah.
One of the things I think coming off the back of when I spoke to you last is one of my favorite matches from when I was growing up is the opening, it's Survivor Series 93. And it's the opening match where obviously your artwork is all over that event anyway, with the, you know, with the cover posters and everything that you had done. But that opening match, you've got 1-2-3 Kid, you've got Razor Ramon, you've got Adam Bomb. And, you know, all the colour and all the, you know, cartoon aspects, I suppose, in that match, the entertainment scale was off the chart. I kind of thought when I spoke to you, if there's a match which, to me, displays your work in a snapshot, surely would be that one, because those three guys alone that you obviously had a hand in creating in a way. Is there anything like that for you? Have you got a moment or a look or something that I don't think I asked this last time, that you hark back to that really represents you back then, your work with the WWF?
Oh man, it's kind of, you know, as far as the actual matches, you know, that's hard to say, but I mean, without a doubt, as far as all the things that I have been involved with and how it came full circle and stuff, was that, you know, the Survivor Series 93, and how much wonderful messages I've received and stuff with that image of that Thanksgiving, you know, the turkey with the, you know, the foreign fanatics and the All-Americans and the two paintings. So I would say, you know, as far as iconic images and stuff, that's probably what I can relate to the best. As far as events, I'm not really sure.
For a period of time, like I say, you were kind of, there were bits of you all over, you know, my favorite events and my favorite moments there. And there's actually one when I was sort of brushing up and looking over your work again in preparation for this, there's one thing that I didn't pick up on that I see that you had a hand in. Again, one of my favorite events from 93, King of the Ring. You designed the sceptre.
Yep.
That's really cool. I mean, it's pretty random in a way as well, from a fan's point of view. But yeah, just tell us what you remember about that, sort of how that came about.
Okay, so yeah, that's okay. So early when I started doing these interviews and stuff, that was one of the memories that came up afterwards, where I wasn't able to talk about it with you. So, I was involved with the first pay-per-view King of the Ring. King of the Ring existed previous, but I didn't even know, you know, what the King of the Ring was, but they came to me and, you know, along with the illustration work and costume designs and things like that, they would actually, they would occasionally ask me and my buddy Jay to actually create props.
Yeah.
So after we created, you know, after we successfully created, you know, costume props like Papa Shango's stuff, then they came to us with the King of the Ring. And well, actually they came to me. It was solely me. And they said, listen, we need a scepter. We need it to look, you know, like something from the set of Indiana Jones, you know, something, and I, you know, I was like, geez, you know, all right, I'll see what I can do. I just started, you know, I went out, got a bunch of art supplies, dowels and styrofoam balls. And the first thing I did was I took one of those styrofoam balls and I went to spray paint it gold to make it look metallic. Mm-hmm. And the styrofoam, because of the, I guess, you know, the alcohol or whatever, the ball completely disintegrated and shriveled. And I was like, oh man, what am I going to do here? And I remember it being a pretty tight crunch of like, we need this, you know, yesterday kind of thing. And my buddy Jay just leaned over and he said, hey, what about doing a solution of Elmer's glue and a little bit of water and kind of doing like a varnish on it and then spray paint it and it'll be kind of sealed. Mm-hmm. And it couldn't have worked better. So, was like, and then once I got that, then all, you know, it was a matter of putting together all these things. And when that project finished up, I remember looking at that thing and it was like with all the design, costume designs and the illustration, I was like so proud of this piece because it was something that I've never really done before to that extent. And I was like, man, this really does look like something off the set of Indiana Jones. And to the point where I went to my art director, or actually the creative director, and I said, hey, you know, they loved the way it came out. And I said, after the event, is there any way that I could get this thing back? You know, I would love to actually, you know, keep it. And they're like, sure, you know, like, we'll see what we can do, that kind of thing. And back in the day, whenever there was big events, we would have like an office party at somebody's apartment or, you know, house. Art department, and we'd all watch the pay-per-view together and we would point out like, oh man, there's so-and-so's banner, there's so-and-so's costume, and have fun doing that. And so we're watching the King of the Ring event. It's the it's the first one on pay-per-view, and you know, of course Brett wins it. And the scepter comes out and he's holding the scepter and they're all like, there it is, you know, like, you know, they're all high fiving me and stuff. And this
literally
is
a crowning moment.
And yeah, and I was like, wow, this is great, you know? And then all of a sudden Jerry Lawler comes tearing through the crowd, slides into the ring, grabs the scepter from Brett, breaks it over his knee, rips the ball off, throws it into the crowd. And everyone just started laughing their asses off. Because everyone knew that I asked to get the thing back. And I was like, all right, well, I guess that's not happening. But no. It was a great event.
I cannot believe this moment right here.
That's another answer.
I will not give him a chance at all. Not at all. That's something. You deserve it, but the Hitman Hart.
I proclaim ye, Brett the Hitman Hart, the King of the Ring.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, my gosh, what a cheap shot. A sucker punch from behind with that scepter. He hit him right with a scepter in the back of the head. Jerry the King Lawler is ruining Bret Hart's moment.
Here's the King right there.
He's done. He's destroyed the crowd.
It's great. And could that have been a rib? Maybe you asking for it made somebody think, oh, wow, we got to do something with this now. You never know.
Exactly. You never know. Yeah, where how word gets around and stuff. Yeah. But I think it was all part of the drama. And, you know, and then it was what it was. So I have this, you know, Lawler thing.
Absolutely. We all did back then with that. That was, I think, the drama of that event. You know, I was a massive Bret Hart fan anyway. I think the story he told through that was fantastic. So that end bit with the coronation and what happened to him was almost like the perfect ending.
Yeah,
for all fans. I will say that was the final thing made of styrofoam, and that then
The what?
This sceptre was actually just the whole thing made of styrofoam, something like that, because that looked real. Obviously, yeah. You know, I'm not sort of expecting it wouldn't do, but I honestly, up till this moment, thought that that was metal and glass on the top or whatever it was.
So, yeah, I just went to a craft store and got, you know, like curtain rod kind of supplies, mm-hmm. and it was styrofoam spray painted to look metallic, and I put pearls and things like that as, you know, just costume jewelry and things like that. And just dressed it up to make it look like it was, made of metal.
That's fantastic. I love the look they had for that King of the Rings. Did you have anything to do with the cape at all as well?
No, the crown, I went out and actually shopped and bought the crown and made the scepter. But no, I'm not sure exactly where the cape came from and who was responsible for that.
Because I thought they, especially with the crown, I was going to come to that actually, because that was the only year, to my knowledge, really, they had a proper crown for it. Because I think what they introduced in 94, which they then used with Triple H and that as well, it just looked this massive furry thing, which looked almost just like fancy dress.
Yeah.
Compared to what Brett had. Did they ask you to do anything else after that, like that sort of prop related that we might recognize?
No, not for that event. For other events, I'm sure. I mean, they were all, you know, pretty much whenever I designed a costume, if anything besides the spandex and the costume, you know, being made, we were pretty responsible for creating, you know, the other props. Yeah. And the challenge was always to, it didn't have to look good. It had to look good and be practical and durable. So it had to be functional, you know, along with actually looking the part.
How many challenges you want in one brief?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Fantastic. That's brilliant. Yeah, I just, as soon as I saw that today, I was like, I've got to ask that, because it's, again, it's one of those, 93, I think, was one of those years that was pretty iconic for me. And there's so many moments in that I still remember today. So that's cool. Moving it a little bit more up to date then, really, one of the main reasons that I wanted to bring you on is when I found out, I think you let me know in a message when I got in touch with you, you were working on something wrestling related. It was all very mysterious. And then you announced it a little while ago, some new artwork that you're doing for an NFT art project. I'm going to let you introduce it and what it is, because I will admit I'm really clueless when it comes to NFT. I still don't actually know what it means, what it is, what it does. So, yeah, again, so how did it come about? Tell us a bit more about what it is and what it will be used for and that kind of thing.
Okay, so let's start with what an NFT is. An NFT is a non-fungible token, which is directly related to cryptocurrency and this whole new wave of the only way to describe it, it's an answer for digital artists to have an original piece of artwork. So, you know, when I do a painting, you know, when I did that Survivor Series painting, there's only one painting. Somebody can buy that, frame it, and hang it on their wall. Digital artists don't have that. It has to be a print. Sure. So they came up with this idea of embedding on the image with a blockchain that actually gets tracked back to the artist, and anytime it's sold or transferred, the artist will get a percentage of that sale.
Okay.
And now it's moved on from digital artist to full-blown art, you know, traditional mm-hmm. artists like myself who paint traditionally. But what happens, I'll get into the whole, the controversy mm-hmm. and the challenges of NFTs. And, you know, some people don't look at them positively. They think of them, they have trouble understanding the value. And there's also an environmental question that, you know, so basically it's a digital collectible is the best way for me to sum it up in, you know, 10 words or less.
That's good.
So, yeah. So the controversy is the environmental is that with all this cryptocurrency, there's mining going on for cryptocurrency where it just takes very, very large computer systems that are working, and it uses a lot of electricity and that kind of thing, which, you know, in any industry, you know, I mean, people are happy to drive to work using.
It's just a really it's just a different version of what we're already doing almost, isn't it?
Yeah. And it's like, you know, electricity with the digital age is just a, it's a, just a fact of life. So, you know, and I'm open to hearing anybody else's opinion. If there's something that I don't know, this is all a learning process for everyone. This is so new and there's so many questions unanswered that everyone is kind of experimenting and exploring this. And this is like, you know, this is, it's been going on, but as far as on a mass scale, this is kind of a ground level type of thing. So basically, NFTs are out there. People are collecting them. Some people love them, look forward to them. And it's just like a trading card. They're, you know, or a comic book or anything collectible. They're collecting these digital images. And, you know, the question that people have is, what do you do with them?
I was going to ask exactly that.
So what do you do with them? Well, it's kind of a strange thing. With all the people that I've been talking to, young and old, there's a mindset. If you're over 30 years old, there's a mindset of like when you invest in, it's got to be a physical thing. So with this whole digital age, and the metaverse is becoming this big thing where it is not a physical world. It's a virtual world. And people are going on the metaverse and creating, you know, like Farmville. And they have gardens, virtual gardens. And it's just their world, their personal world. And it's kind of a hard thing to understand. But they're, to the younger crowd, there's a value. And there's a... you know, they're a big interest in all of this stuff. So NFTs are a virtual art world, and there is eventually going to be metaverse galleries, and so you'll be able to display your NFT collection in these virtual galleries. You can, you know, of course you have them on your phone, your laptop, or whatever, and you can use them as wallpaper. You can use, you know, with a digital image. But eventually this metaverse, there will be museums and galleries and things like that displaying these images.
That's very cool. So you look at some of these things, when you say like Farmville and whatever, I'm of a certain age where I can kind of, I've grown up with a lot of this stuff, I suppose, but still to me, it's a game.
It's a game,
You know, I can't get my head into something that almost has no end. When I pick up a video game, I'm going towards the end of the story. I want to know what happens. And so it's never really, I've never got it. I've never delved into it. It's never really appealed to me. So, I mean, you saying that, I mean, it's amazing what they can do now and how it's changing what you do, because it's given you almost another avenue that you can explore that wasn't there before.
Exactly. And it's super exciting, because I'm not one to ever be like, back in the day, we, you know, our way was the best. I'm always like, it's a different thing. Our parents said the same thing. My grandparents said the same thing. And I am totally open-minded and look forward to any, you know, technological advances and things like that. And, you know, interested in, you know, hey, how can I get involved and things like that. So this opportunity presented itself to me by with all the postings that I did on Facebook, and how this whole revival for my WWE, WWF career came full circle. This group a company called Fight Capital contacted me, and they said, we have this project. It's 23 paintings of the of wrestlers from all back in the day in the 80s all the way up until current time, 2022, and we are doing an NFT project that will also be converted into a whole video game world. So they're creating this whole kind of system that is going to be connected with these NFTs. And if you own the NFT, you will be able to play as that character. And it's complicated to the point, but all the answers are actually, I just posted on my Facebook page today, the contact information, if you want more questions and answers and things like that, to Fight Capital's Discord connection. So this is interesting because you timed this absolutely perfectly.
Seven.
In the next day or two, they're going to go live with the sale of this NFT project.
Cool.
So they came to me and they said, hey, we need these 23 paintings. We need that. It's going to be everyone from like way back to like, you know, the mid to late 80s. Mm-hmm. Right till now. And we have the exclusive rights to, we're working directly with the wrestlers and or the estates of the wrestlers if they're deceased.
Yeah.
Project completely directly benefits the wrestler or their estates.
Wow.
So yeah, which was a wonderful thing to hear. So one of the first one that I did was the exclusive Andre the Giant NFT, which was just, you know, super exciting. You know, to be able to create, the challenge was to create a very simple iconic image, and that's what all of these are. They're kind of like busts of avatars of each wrestler, because they're going to be actually used as the avatar for the wrestler in the video game.
Sure.
So the catch was they needed 23 paintings in about 23 days.
Wow.
And that's insane. Yeah. Like literally insane.
Yeah. That is. And I mean, obviously, have you done them all? Nowadays, obviously, I'm guessing the 23 days was back along. You've done them all. They're ready to go with them.
They're all done. And I have never done that much work in that short of time. Wow. And they wanted to launch the NFT drop during WrestleMania weekend.
Okay.
And so that was why the crunch.
Yeah.
It turns out that it was just not realistic to do that. There was too much promotion that needed to be done to do it right. There was too many details of finishing up the artwork digitally, and because what they asked me to do was paint the wrestlers with white backgrounds, and then they were going to drop in graphics for variations, for variants of the wrestlers. So there's, you know, all in all, there's 8,000 NFTs that are going to go up for sale of these 23 images.
Wow.
Some of them are rarer than others. And it's going to be a really exciting thing. Now, the problem that we face is that since the time we started working on this project till now, cryptocurrency and that whole thing has crashed.
Yeah.
But that's a positive for anyone who's interested in getting involved, because the price has dramatically dropped. Jeez. And there's very little risk or any expense that's going to be, if you want to, you know, take a chance and get involved with this. It literally went originally from couple of $100 per NFT to now it's whatever Solana is valued at, which is going to be about it's somewhere around $30 to $40.
Okay. So it could almost go in your favor, almost in a weird kind of way, because I suppose, is it, correct me if I'm wrong, getting them sold the first time, that's just the beginning. Like you say, it can be sold on and on and on, you know, it at least gets it out there.
Correct.
And then it can almost just snowball, couldn't it?
That's kind of that's the silver lining, I guess, they're looking at with this, is that the initial sale is not going to be originally massive,
but
Yeah, but we'll see what happens. And then there's going to be wave two, and you know, I'll let them announce that. That's not for me to divulge yet, but there will be a wave two. And so this project, it was wonderful to get involved with the WWE, WWF characters again. And I worked on everything from Andre to Macho Man to Hawk from Legion of Doom. Then Rob Van Dam is actually a partner in this. There's a bunch of there is talent that's actually partners in this Fight Capital company.
Okay, all right. That's cool. So at least you've got some, obviously you have some people in the know who've got the passion behind it to drive it as well, which is great.
Yeah, exactly. Yes.
That's cool. You mentioned some of the guys there, obviously like Andre and the Macho Man. I think you did Davey Boy Smith. Am I right?
Yep. Davey Boy Smith and the Dynamite Kid.
Oh, that's cool. Yeah. So it's guys that you, back when you were working in WWF in the early to mid 90s, guys you wouldn't have necessarily worked on anything current with. I guess you could have done the artwork yourself on them, on any images that you wanted to in retrospect, but you know, what does it feel like about getting involved with them in something current, you know, these guys that you didn't have a chance to really do anything with back then?
Exactly. Yeah, there was a matter of fact, ironically, with all the, you know, 23 paintings that I did, and there's variation, I did some variation paintings where they, you know, if they had face paint, and if they're seen without, I did a version without the face paint, with the face paint. It was ironically not one of my characters that I created back in the 90s is part of the NFT drop.
Right.
So Razor and Adam Bomb and Papa Shango and all. So who knows? Maybe they'll.
I was gonna say they'd be ideal for that kind of thing, I think, because you know, I mean, their artwork of within themselves, aren't they? The imagery.
Exactly. Yeah. They really lend itself to a digital collectible that kind of cool, trading card kind of image.
That's cool. And they had to be, what I've seen, what you put out already, had to be from certain eras. Did they specify what eras, specific eras they had to be from?
Oh, actually, great question. Not only was it, I did not have my choice of what version of the wrestler to paint. They actually had specific years. Yeah. So Hawk was like Hawk 1987, you know, like where it was within the black, the black.
The NWA style, wasn't it? Yeah, back then, yeah.
Yeah, the original face paint. Yeah, exactly. There was very specific years to Kurt Angle. His rookie year was the one that I painted. And in his rookie year, he actually only wore trunks. He didn't even wear the singlet and stuff until later, until later that year. So yeah, he debuted with trunks. So I did a version of that. And then we did the, you know, the American singlets with his gold medals. And those are all different variations that,
So you've got the guys who are making these decisions, obviously, you've already mentioned a couple of names already from the industry that are involved anyway. They've obviously got appreciation for these guys from a particular point in their career to want to represent them in that way, I guess.
Yeah. And it's also nice to know that the proceeds, their percentage of the proceeds is going right to their estates them. Because a lot of these guys, you know, the guys from the old, so a lot of them are struggling and could use the assistance, you know, whatever that may be. It wasn't big money then, way back when. It's nice to know that there's these avenues that can help the families and also the wrestlers.
It's one thing that I guess since lockdown, I've seen a lot of, I don't know whether it's lockdown or whether it's just put it more to the forge. It's just kind of coincidental, but I've seen a lot of digital artists come to the fore. It seems to have become obviously the big thing as technology's moved on. And I was concerned in a way that it was going more that way and that, you know, the appreciation for traditional art and artists like yourself would almost sort of fade away in favor of this, not easier, I won't say it's easier, but it's almost like a more accessible way of doing it, possibly, I'm not sure. But you've given hope there, you know, if you're just one of them who's been able to find another avenue to, you know, to add to what you already do. That's amazing, mate. That's amazing.
Yeah. And actually, you know, you're touching on something that, you know, you're right. All of a sudden there's been an explosion of digital art as far as collectability, but as a profession, this, for me, the concerns and the anxiety started 15 years ago, 10, 15 years, where I was like, am I going to be a dinosaur? And, you know, I paint traditionally. Oh my God, are all these projects going to start just going digital? And the answer is no. I'm fortunate enough to be in an industry with comic books. There's always an appreciation for traditional art. Mm-hmm. And what happened was there was a big wave of, you know, things going digitally. But then the question I would get at conventions and shows is, you know, did you do this by hand? And when I said yes, there was like, oh, wow. Yeah. Like, you know, people appreciate when you do something by hand.
Yeah.
So it almost made, made me more of a specialist.
That's like, cool. Yeah, absolutely. Because you've got that, I guess you can learn the art of digital art. Probably, you know, again, I'm saying I've never looked into it myself. I'm guessing it's more accessible just because of technology is there for you to do it. But you can prove that you can use both. So, I mean, you know, you almost can't teach what you know already and your experience and what you've gained and everything. So
true. And that all came together with this NFT project because things had to be done so quickly and I had so little time. I had to kind of really utilize whatever digital skills that I have. So I would do these paintings, and they're small, you know, there a lot of them are about this big. I would do these paintings about maybe like 90%, 90 to 95%. And instead of worrying about finishing them off and cleaning them up and them looking as like nice paintings, I would just get them to a point and then scan them in and finish them off in Photoshop.
Okay. And
sped things up so dramatically that I gained this huge appreciation for Photoshop for this type of project.
Yeah.
But I just thought, I just remembered a very interesting factor in this project. Because these are NFTs and digital, and the value is in these digital images, I painted them traditionally. So there's 23 paintings, that physical paintings that I have, that I had.
Yeah.
The question was, well, what happens to these paintings?
Yeah.
They get sold also? And the answer was, no, we are going to do a public burning.
What?
Oh, how crazy is that to hear that after working? No way. So they are going to do a public burning of 23 of my paintings, probably in the next day or so. And I'm waiting to hear the, you know, what the update is of when that's going to happen. But
they're going to send you the ashes.
Yeah, right. Like, seriously, like a cremation. Oh my God, that's hilarious. I should have the ashes in an urn.
I can't believe that. Yeah. So, I mean, yeah, I guess you're producing for a reason and they will exist within the realm they were supposed to, but.
Yeah.
Is that so they couldn't be resold?
Exactly.
Yeah.
So you have to instill into the buyer the faith that this is a one of a kind thing. You are buying a one of a kind, and there's the value is in this NFT, this exclusive NFT. And, you know, and the, you know, these were all questions that I had because I didn't really know what NFTs were when I took on this project. So most people are like, oh my God, are you like freaking out about this? And the answer actually was, it was kind of, it was actually good news to me when they told me that, because it made it legit to me.
Okay, fair enough.
Trying to create this kind of, you know, because people have those doubts about NFTs. And to me, that makes it legit. And I don't like to get involved with anything, you know, that's not on the up and up. And if you're going to sell something, it should be of the value that you're proposing. So,
yeah. That's tragic, but yeah, brilliant at the same time, actually.
Exactly.
But yeah, it's one of those, isn't it? Painful things to, but there we go. You know, you can, that's a cool thing to say, I suppose. Are they going to send you any footage of it or?
Yes.
Yeah, oh, really?
They're going to have it professionally filmed and edited and stuff. And they're going to, yes. And so I don't know exactly what form it will come in, if it's going to be a link or whatever, but I will absolutely be sharing that footage with, you know, with my social media following.
Yeah, I'll look out for that.
And yeah, that's going to be, you know, kind of a fun, I can't wait to hear some of the comments that, you know, that the followers will have.
It's something you won't get with any of your other work, isn't it, really? You don't like to think that anything else you've done will end up on a bonfire somewhere, but wow.
Exactly.
That's brilliant. Yeah. That's brilliant.
Yeah, so, it's never a dull moment.
Never dull. No, absolutely. Absolutely. I know obviously a lot of the stuff you work on, until it's been formally announced and everything, you can't really, you know, talk too much about. Is there, besides the wrestling for a second, is there any other projects you've got ongoing or that have just come out that you can talk about? Because I might have, you know, some comic book fans out there that are watching and listening to this that'd be interested.
Yeah, sure. Actually, they just announced like last week or so the Fleer Ultra Avengers trading card set that I did. I did 9 paintings. They're already using one of my paintings of the Vision in the promotions, and it's the main image that comes up when you Google Ultra Avengers 2022. Okay. Boom, a Vision comes right up. So it's always nice when the company, when you do work in the company, you know, is happy enough to use your images to promote. And if it shows up on the packaging and the box and all that kind of stuff. But yeah, the Avengers trading card set is, they didn't announce a release date yet, but they are starting to share the artwork. I'll be actually sharing the artwork on my social media. And selling the artwork also. I'll be doing eBay auctions and then sharing the links for anyone that's interested. And then you know, I have quite a few projects going on with that type of stuff, but I can't announce that the others yet. But there's quite a few.
So if guys, anyone watching this who's done already, you can get you can find out about Tom's work on the social media, Art of Tom Fleming, on Facebook. Just remind us about the other social media that you're on, your handles.
Okay, so Instagram is Tom Fleming Artwork, at Tom Fleming Artwork. Yes, Facebook is The Art of Tom Fleming, or just Tom Fleming. There's multiple Tom Flemings, but you'll clearly see which one is mine.
Yeah.
And then Twitter is at Flem_art. Those are the three main ones. And then, you know,
I'll stick those out on the post and everything anyway, like I do. And I'm just trying to think, you know, I your work fascinates me. It really does. You know, art was something that I loved at school, but I was never good enough at it to sort of apply myself beyond that. And I kind of look at, you know, I write so I can, in a sense, create something out of nothing with words. But I love just looking at good art, you know, good artwork. And I think your comic book stuff, I don't read comics. I've never been a big comic book collector, but I must admit the one thing that always draws me to it is the quality of the artwork that goes into it. It just kind of sucks you into whatever world it is that you're creating. So I guess things like, you know, going out in, you know, once COVID is now lifted, your public appearances, I guess, picked up, like you do conventions and stuff. Have you found that there's a new market that come to you that recognize you now for your wrestling work as well?
Well, I will be able to answer that question. I have not done any shows this year yet, okay. But my first one is next week at Awesome Con in Washington, D.C. I'll be there June, the first weekend of June. and really looking forward to getting back out there and seeing everybody. Mm-hmm. And I'll find out, you know, like if the wrestling stuff has, you know, is getting that cross, you know, yeah, that kind of cross marketing between the comics. Yeah. And we'll see. I, you know, the ones I did last year, there was definitely already a response from in the comic world to the wrestling stuff that Yeah, we had no idea, that kind of thing. Yeah.
Bobby, wrestling comic books, I know there's been a few thrown around in the past. You never know, might be another thing you get roped into at some point. Is there, if that was possible, here you go, here's one to throw. If that was possible, I think I probably know the answer, but what of the characters you've created in the wrestling world then, who would you like to work on a comic book for? Who do you think has got the best backstory?
I would say as far as translation from comic book to, from wrestling to comic book, I mean, the first three that come to mind, of course, is Papa Shango, Adam Bomb, and Razor. You know, without a doubt, the three, you know, those three. I mean, as far as a comic book character, when I created and designed Adam Bomb, the Adam Bomb costume, that was the, like my first opportunity to do my own thing where they just let me kind of do my own. So that was actually my comic book world kind of being kind of threw out there and they took to it, you know, where, you know, Razor and Papa Shango, they gave me those themes and I just created the look. But
That's cool. I could imagine them all in the same universe probably as well, in some weird way. Papa Shango's got quite a like Baron Samedi kind of feel to it. James Bond, again, wasn't a film I grew up with. I know the imagery. Was there a bit of that influence in there? I know you referenced.
It was, when they came to me, it was more of, they told me to watch Serpent in the Rainbow.
Yeah.
That was the, you know, my only really frame of reference besides the kind of voodoo kind of image that I already kind of had in my head.
Yeah. It's very cool to see Charles Wright actually still turning up at events as Papa Shango now. You know,
I didn't know that.
I've seen some. Yeah, I mean, as much as he does like The Godfather and that, I've seen him at Comic Cons. I think he's also probably done some independent wrestling, you know, in the last couple of years as Papa Shango. And, you know, it's fantastic to see him still out there, you know, with that imagery.
Oh, without a doubt. You know, it must be, you know, as far as like, you know, preparation and stuff, he's got to do the face paint, which probably was a deterrent for a while. But now,
dedication.
Yeah, I would love to bump into Charles and see him at a show or, you know, at some point.
Yeah, he sounds like a hell of a character.
Yes, and a super nice guy from, you know, from my experience. Mm. The little interaction that I had with him he was super, what a pleasant, you know, really super guy.
He was one that, again, a credit to you, I suppose. He scared the hell out of me when I was a kid. He really did. Along with the likes of Demolition and that, I think they were guys that just pulverized everyone. But I think, it was just his look. He was him and Kamala, I think, there at the same time. Very, very, very strange. Didn't know what to think of him. You know, brilliant. Listen, I'll just give us, before we finish up, just going back to your NFT work as well, just give us a shout out where we can find more information. You said you put the links on your page. Where in a couple of days you say it's they're going up for sale or whatever the launch is. Just give a bit of a shout out for that and where people can find more information about getting involved.
Okay, actually, the only information that I can give is that the company is called Fight Capital. And if you Google Fight Capital, I'm sure all their social media comes up. But I just earlier, I mean, literally, when I told you that I would be 5 minutes, I was literally finishing up the post on my Facebook page with that information. So if you go to The Art of Tom Fleming I haven't done it on Instagram yet, that the link is actually on my page and you can click on that and Fight Capital will answer any questions that you have if you join the Discord how to get involved and, you know, there's a certain process.
It sounds fantastic. It's such a great thing. And it's not just about, you know, putting work out there to make money for someone. It's going, you know, back to back to these guys, these superstars. So, you know, it's a great thing all around. You know, thank you, Tom, for sparing us the time and come tell us more about it. And yeah, all the best with it. And, and whatever else comes, you know, yeah, the next wave, if there is more to come, we'll be keeping an eye on that. That'd be really exciting.
Yeah, I'll absolutely keep you posted and stuff and check in every once in a while. You know, I'm happy to, you know, take some time out to, you know, to talk to you and, you know, get the word out.
I appreciate that, mate. No, thank you so much. You've made the 50th, I say, milestone 50th episode of Once Upon a Turnbuckle. You know, thank you, Tom. You were one of my favorite guests back then. This is a fantastic way of commemorating this point in the series. So, no, thank you again. And, you know, we'll do this again at some point in the future.
Fantastic. Sounds great. And I really appreciate you having me.
No problem, mate. Anytime.
Okay.
If you enjoyed this episode, please take a moment to like, share, and hit the subscribe button. Also follow us on Facebook and Instagram to keep updated about all future shows.